We were just reminded our Advent theme this week is joy. Let's begin with a word of prayer. Lord, we invite you into this service and into our lives today. May we allow your joy to bubble up and overflow out of our hearts today. Right now in our world, there seems to be so much anxiety, mistrust, frustration, and emptiness in people's lives. Replace it, we pray, with your joy, your peace, your hope. Use our lives to demonstrate your love today, we pray. May your joy be seen in our countenance. May your joy in our lives encourage and minister to others today. We simply ask now, in the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. Well, welcome to Kenfield Pentecostal Church Online. I hope you are enjoying this Christmas season and preparing your lives to celebrate Jesus. Join in and worship now, and let's exalt the name of our Lord today.
In the name of the Father, in the name of the Son, in the name of the Spirit, Lord, we come. We are gathered together to lift up your name, to call on our Savior, to fall on your grace. Hear the joyful sound of our offering as your saints bow down, as your people sing. We will rise with you, lifted on your wings.
In your name. have heard on high, sweetly singing o'er the plains and the mountains in reply, echoing their joyous strains. Gloria in excelsis Deo.
Thank you.
O Come, O Come, Emmanuel. What a great song of hope, reminding us of Jesus' love and the plan that he has for us. It's a song of invitation. And right now we're going to go to the Lord in prayer and invite Emmanuel, Jesus, to come and to minister, to answer the prayer needs in our hearts and in our lives. Let's join in and pray. So Jesus, we come before you today. We bring the needs of our church and our church family, our nation before you. We especially pray for little baby Oliver, that you would continue to help his lungs form. Give life and health and strength, we pray. Encourage his family. May they be reminded how much you love and care for them, I pray. I think of Lorna's cousin. I pray for Elva and Ken. I pray for Paul, Jan, Lance, Donna. And Lord, there are several special unspoken prayer requests upon my heart. And you know what they are. You know what the unspoken prayer requests are upon your people today. Lord, you know the individuals. You know the circumstances. And so we come and bring them before you. Thank you for the good progress that Dave has made after his surgery. And we just pray that it would continue. Lord, we pray for our nation. We pray for our leaders. And so we bring them before you, believing you to help them in their leadership, to help them make the right and the best decisions. And just pray your blessing into their personal lives. I pray that each one of them would have the opportunity to have a believer speak into their lives this Christmas season, reminding them what the real meaning of Christmas is all about. And I pray that many would discover you as their Lord and Savior as well this Christmas season. Lord, for all the people displaced, whether it's a flood or a tornado, whatever the natural disaster would be, we think of people that are homeless because of other circumstances and situations, that you would be with them, we pray. We pray for those who are lonely, those who are hurting, the sick, those in financial crisis. Lord, we pray for those who are battling drug and alcohol situations, those mourning the loss of loved ones. Lord, we bring all these people before you, and we ask you to make the difference in each person's life, we pray today. Lord, I think of David, who wrote from experience, weeping may stay overnight, but there's joy in the morning. There's joy in the morning when we discover you to be the King of Kings and Lord of Lords and invite you to be in our hearts and our lives. May that be theirs as well as our experience, because Lord, you are a loving, merciful, caring God. You are all powerful. And so we simply bring these needs before you today and leave them at your feet. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. Amen. We are now going to sing, in preparation for our sermon today, Mary, Did You Know? I trust and hope that you allowed this song, Mary Did You Know, to speak into your heart and lives today. I want to begin by asking you a question to reflect upon. If you could change one thing in the Christmas story today, what would it be? Would you perhaps change the location of the birth into a proper room rather than in a manger or in a stable? Would you have Mary and Joseph travel or move to from Nazareth to Bethlehem earlier so Mary did not have to travel during her 9th month of pregnancy? Would have you changed that all the boys' babies under 2 years of age around Bethlehem would not have been killed? Would you write yourself into the Christmas story? Or what else would you change? Think about those things and we'll come back to the question later on. In Luke chapter 1, verses 26 to 45, please turn in your Bible, Luke chapter 1, verses 26 to 45. In the 6th month, the angel Gabriel was sent by God to a town in Galilee called Nazareth, to a virgin engaged or betrothed to a man named Joseph of the house of David. The virgin's name was Mary. And the angel came to her and said, "Greetings, favored woman, the Lord is with you." Traditionally, the translations put, "Blessed are you among women." Verse 29 says, "But Mary was deeply troubled by this statement, wondering what kind of greeting could this be. Then the angel told her, 'Do not be afraid, Mary, for you have found favor with God.'" Let me stop there. Last week, the same line, "Do not be afraid." And too often, I think we need to be reminded, do not be afraid when God speaks to you. When the Bible challenges us and we're trying to do the right, the biblically, the godly thing, and it seems hard, or the world is making fun of us, never, never, never be afraid to trust God, to let God's plans become your plans. So don't be afraid. God is always there. And I find that very reassuring and builds up my faith. And yet I know there may be at times and circumstances that would come my way, and my natural inclination may be to be afraid. But God wants us to know we don't have to be afraid. We can trust in Him. Verse 31 continues. Now listen. I wonder if God were to get our attention, if He would have to say to you and us today, now listen, pay attention, slow down, take time to listen. Would we actually pay attention to what God wants to say to us? Would we hear His voice? And so, don't be afraid, Mary. Listen to what I have to say. And the angel continues on, "You will conceive and give birth to a son, and you will name him Jesus. He will be great and will be called the Son of the Most High. And the Lord will give him the throne of his father David. He will reign over the house of Jacob forever, and his kingdom will have no end." But Mary asks the angel, "How can this be, since I have not had sexual relations with a man?" Then the angel replied to her, "The Holy Spirit will come upon you, and the power of the Most High will overshadow you. Therefore, the Holy One to be born will be called the Son of God. And consider your relative Elizabeth. Even she has conceived a son in her old age, and this is the sixth month for her who is called childless. For nothing will be impossible with God. Let me stop there. For nothing will be impossible with God. I almost trip over those words. Really? Really? Because this is the opposite to our experience. We have so many limits. We sometimes feel so helpless in the face of so many challenges that might come our way. But when this word of the angel speaks to us as it did to Mary, as it did to Elizabeth, as it did to Zechariah, as it did to Joseph, when this truly becomes our conviction, our prayers will be more powerful, more effectively, and they will truly be prayers of faith. It encourages us to believe God in every situation, for nothing will be impossible with God. You know, Elizabeth's husband, Zechariah, that we looked at last week, was getting well up there in age. And so was Elizabeth. And some of us can relate to them. But may we never use our aging or our age as an excuse and simply say, God, you can't use me. God wants to use us. And in fact, he has a plan. Now, if we look at Mary's life, she was just a teen. And very much her life was still ahead of her. She had her dreams, her goals for her life. But God interrupts Mary's life and does the unthinkable, the miraculous, without even asking her or without her even asking him. She didn't ask to become pregnant. How can it be? She said. Notice a committed believer whose life God was pleased with. That's who Mary was. God intervened without her being asked. Is it okay, Mary? God intervened. I don't know exactly what that means in my life or yours today, but I want to tell you, I want to encourage you to invite God to do what he wants in your life. And sometimes what he wants to do, we may not see, but he knows it needs to be done. And so let's be people of faith and trust God to do what needs to be done. Both of these unusual occurrences in Elizabeth and Mary's lives were a part of God's plan for their individual lives and the plan for his Savior and the plan for the whole world. And I want you to know that we too need to be careful that we don't just think, that we just don't presume that our plans are God's plans. This also applies when something unexpected happens, especially when it appears to be hard or bad for us. We need to trust God and be people of faith. And we too need to understand, for nothing will be impossible with God. He will get us through according to his plan. I sure don't always understand God's timing of his plan. Why sometimes it seems we have to wait forever. We kind of wonder, will it ever happen? But may we simply not just spin our wheels trying to figure out all the questions and all the things about God's timing, trying to figure everything out. But you and I, may we just simply trust and fully trust his plan for our lives. May God forgive us when we blame him and his plan for the bad things that come our way, which really oftentimes that we're just reaping what we have sown as sinful actions in our lives. When going our way seemed right rather than God's way. You know, we need to ask God for discernment, to know the difference, and so that we can trust God, so we will know when it is just our way or when it truly is his way. When you don't understand what's happening, don't condemn yourself, but trust God, trust his plan, and remember, for nothing will be impossible with God. When you don't know how you're going to get out of the situation, believe this scripture verse, for nothing will be impossible with God. Verse 38 continues, "See, I am the Lord's servant," said Mary. "May it happen to me as you said." Then the angel left. Can you and I willingly and honestly say, "I am the Lord's servant. May it happen to me as you say"? You know, sometimes I think we're only the servant when there's no one else, or we are forced to do it, or we do it grudgingly with a bad attitude, but not Mary here. And I want us to be able to say that. We often wrestle in our heart our priorities, but I want to encourage us to make that priority, make that commitment today, and allow us to give the Holy Spirit's overcoming power and to be given, living it out as we would say, "I am the Lord's servant. May it happen to me as you say." And as I look at that, I don't really know the implications for your life and my life, practically what they will be. But I know that needs to be our story. That needs to be your commitment and my commitment. I am the Lord's servant. May it happen to me, Lord, just as you say. In verse 39, it continues, "In those days, Mary set out and hurried to a town in the hill country of Judea. When she entered Zechariah's house and greeted Elizabeth, Elizabeth heard Mary's greeting, and the baby leaped inside her, and Elizabeth was filled with the Holy Spirit. Then she exclaimed with a loud cry, 'Blessed are you among women, and your child will be blessed. How could this happen to me that the mother of my Lord should come to me? For you see, when the sound of your greeting reached my ears, the baby leaped for joy inside me. Blessed is she who believed that the Lord will fulfill what he had spoken to her.'" And Elizabeth is just reaffirming to Mary what God had said and what Mary was now experiencing. "Blessed are you that the Lord would fulfill what he has spoken to you because you simply believe." May we believe. May we take God's word and believe it with all our heart, soul, mind, and strength. And Mary's response to Elizabeth's words of encouragement are really a song of praise. Verse 46, it says, "And Mary said, 'My soul magnifies you, Lord. My spirit rejoices in God my Savior. He who is mighty has done great things for me. His mercy flows from generation to generation. Holy is his name. In his strength, he will scatter the proud. He will bring down the mighty and exalt the humble. From this abundance, he will fill the hungry. In his mercy, he will save us. My soul magnifies you, Almighty God." And Mary stayed with her about 3 months. Then she returned to her home. Let me encourage you to be full of spontaneous praise, worship, and song, just as Mary did that day. She allowed herself, and may we allow ourselves often, to break out of our mold and to begin to express daily what we see God doing. There is so much to praise God for, and may we take advantage of that and praise God, beginning with simply beginning who Jesus is, Emmanuel, the Savior, God, the creator of the universe. And then we can also look back and praise God for what he has and what he is doing in our hearts and our lives right now. As I read that song of Mary, what line reached out and spoke to you today? Did you pick up on Mary's joy? My soul magnifies the Lord, and my spirit rejoices with God, my Savior. She was overflowing with joy. May our praise manifest that joy. But interesting, my spirit rejoices in God, my Savior. It spoke of her relationship. And that relationship had been a long time cultivated relationship with Jesus. And so she was just expressing her joy and her relationship with God. Wherever you are in your spiritual journey, whether you've been with the Lord a long time on that journey, or whether you're just a new believer, express that joy, appreciate the relationship that you have with your Lord. My spirit rejoices in my God, my Savior, because he has looked upon me with favor. Her faith and hope and testimony are reflected in the lines, "The Mighty One has done great things for me, and his name is holy. His mercy is from generation to generation on those who fear him. He has done a mighty deed." Boy, that expresses her faith. The Mighty One expresses her faith, what God has done. It renews her hope. It is her story. It is her testimony. You know, each of us have a testimony of what God, a story, what God has done and is doing in our hearts and lives. May that just cause us to share it, but to praise God and lift up our hands, our hearts, our lives in praise and adoration and worship to him, the King of Kings and Lord of Lords. Let me ask you the question, when has something worked out differently than you expected? And as you look back and see that, do you now see God's fingerprint on it? Where at the time you didn't know where God was, you didn't know what was happening? Can you look back and see God's timing on the things that were happening? I want to remind you, God has a plan for your life individually. God has a plan for this church family collectively. You know, I began by asking you what you would change in the Christmas story. Really, it was a bold and presumptuous question. Who are we to question God? Who are we to try to rewrite his plan for us? And yet, sometimes we do that. A better question for us is, what do you want to change in my life, Lord? What do you want to change in my plans moving forward? We need to tell God and make it a commitment. God, I trust your wisdom and mercy. I pray, I ask you to reveal your plan in your time to me. I trust your plan for my life and commit myself to follow it. Well, let's begin right now with what we know today God's plan is for your life. First of all, he wants to be your God. He wants to be your Savior. He wants you to trust him today and tomorrow. No matter what comes, he wants to be your God. He wants to be in that covenant relationship with you. And so if you're not a believer, today is the day for you to make that commitment. And if you are a believer, continue to make and recommit your hearts and lives to him. Begin with that. I trust and pray that Mary's words would be our words from our heart, and they would be our words of faith and commitment. I am the Lord's servant. I serve the Lord. May it happen to me just as you said it would. There are all kinds of promises in God's word. May we take them to heart and say, Lord, I'm trusting you to keep your word, just like you said. Even though it wasn't in her plan, Mary trusted God. As God unveiled and unraveled his plan that she would become the mother of our Lord Jesus Christ. God had a plan for Mary all along. And she trusted God, even though things worked out differently than she expected. I want to remind you and myself that God has a plan for us. We don't always understand it, where it's going, but we need to trust him. And the good news is we can trust him. And sometimes along that plan, things will be hard, things will be tough. But that's when we need to be reminded, with God, nothing will be impossible. He can do all things. He wants to make the difference in your heart and your life. And so, Lord, as we stop and come before you, we pray to you as the King of Kings and Lord of Lords, and we want that kind of a relationship with you. Reveal your plan to us and help us to submit that plan. Help us to realize that the Holy Spirit will empower us to live through the plan and to accomplish what you want through our hearts and our lives. To those who are new Christians today, cement that plan in their lives, I pray. Lord, thank you that none of us in ourselves are worthy, but Jesus took our place on the cross that we might have that abundant, eternal, meaningful life with you. And Lord, that life means that you have a plan for us. For any who are struggling today, Lord, I pray that you would just encourage them to trust you. Lord, if they need to change their plans and abandon their plans so that yours would become yours, I pray that that would be done. Lord, in your mercy, in your graciousness, forgive us when we went our way instead of your way and when we made a mess of things. But Lord, we believe you to do the impossible and somehow bring good out of our mistakes, bring good out of our sins, because Lord, you are our Redeemer today, we pray. Thank you, Lord. And Lord, I just pray now that your joy would just bubble up out of our hearts and lives as we wait upon you and worship you today, we pray in Jesus' name, amen. Would you join in and worship with the great Christmas carol, Joy to the World, the Lord has come. Joy to the world, the Lord has come. I trust that you will take time to share his love, his joy, his peace, the hope we have with Jesus Christ. Remember, we have those little booklets called Hope, if you'd like one to share with someone. I trust that you will take advantage of the many opportunities to share this Christmas, share with a neighbor, to share with children around the world through the AirDo projects that we have going with, to feed families, to make a difference in their lives, to reach out to a neighbor, someone at work, and just express a little bit of God's love towards them. You know, we can't change the world all at once, but together we can change one life at a time. And that's all God expects us to do. So I trust that you would just be busy sharing his love. Take time to appreciate and remember what Christmas is all about. Jesus came to be our Savior. And then share that good news. So, Father, thank you today that we have the opportunity of loving you, serving you, and telling others about you. I pray that we would do it and do it with the power of the Holy Spirit that would change lives. Lord, thank you that you chose us. And we're grateful for the plan that you have for our hearts and lives. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. So see the opportunities that are listed in my email that I send out, staying in touch, be a part of them, find your own opportunities. And again, we're here if you need prayer or if there's a special need that you have, please reach out to us, 613-851-5779, call or text, or send me an email And we will do our part, whatever we can do, to share God's love, his truth with each one of you. God bless. Have a great week. And just a reminder, we will be having a Christmas Eve service at 6 o'clock on Friday, December the 24th. And so you're invited to come and join with us. Be a blessing this week. And remember, he gives us joy.
Adore him. Oh, come, let us adore.